Thank you very much. Before I tell you anything else, I want you to know, I see a shrink, we're good. I've been actually seeing the same shrink since 2007. I didn't start dating the woman who's now my wife until 2012. My shrink's name is Barb, which I think we can all agree, that's the perfect name for a shrink. And Barb's the best. Even though Barb is kinda the worst. Like, mostly because she's not necessarily good at it, you know? Like, she's not good at actually being a doctor. When you're a doctor, there's all kinds of rules that go along with that. When I started with Barb, I was like, I don't think she knows that. But then very quickly, I'm like, oh, wait, no. She just doesn't give a shit, man. She once spent a portion of a session sitting on the couch with me, showing me pictures on an iPad of a house she bought in Mexico. That's also how she let me know that she was moving to Mexico. All of our sessions now happen via Skype, oftentimes while she is lounging in a hammock. She has seen me in many shows over the years. She's come out to live shows, and that's very nice. It's very supportive, I get that. But there are these things called boundary issues. You don't want those being crossed. She once saw me in a show here in New York, and my parents also attended that show, and they lived near each other in New Jersey at the time, and Barb asked my parents for a ride home, and they gave it to her. If you're not familiar with how this type of doctor-patient relationship is supposed to go, it's not supposed to end with your shrink and your parents alone in a car. But there's a reason I stayed with her as long as I have. I mean, it's been a decade. She can be great. There's a lot of crazy stuff, and you'll hear a lot of that, but she can also be great. One time she says to me, she goes, you know what your basic problem is? Your reactions to things are not in proportion to the things you're reacting to. And that just, because that's very true about me. That has always been true. Really big things will happen in my life, and I'll be like, whatever, who cares? And then these tiny little things will just spiral out of control. Like my wife's incredible. I think my wife's a perfect human being outside of one flaw. She does, she has one flaw. If she opens a cabinet door, that cabinet door stays open. That is a fact. I don't even know if she's aware that they move in the other direction. And unfortunately for me, with my anxiety mixed with my slight OCD, if a cabinet door is open, and it doesn't have to be, that feels to me like the entire world is falling apart. And there's one night where she and I are in bed and I can't fall asleep because I know that in our kitchen, there is a cabinet door and it is open. And I'm in my head, I'm going, who cares? Let it go. There are no negative repercussions to a cabinet door being open right now. And then I think to myself, you can't make that promise. And I'm going, don't do it. It is crazy if you do it. But I do. I get out of bed and I tiptoe into our kitchen and I close the cabinet door. And when I do, I say out loud, it's over. Now, clearly that does not deserve that reaction. Barb is on the money when it comes to this one, and maybe I should know that about myself. Maybe I should know that my reactions don't always make sense. I really didn't. And for her to tell me that in such a simple way, that's the type of wisdom Barb drops every once in a while that makes it so worth it to stay with her. Even though she also says things like the time she told me that she believes human brains are actually computers invented by aliens and placed inside our heads. My shrink told me that. She didn't just tell me that. She forgot she told me that and reiterated it 8 months later. So I bet for a lot of people, the big question is why, right? Like, why do you have to see a shrink? That cabinet door thing isn't so bad, and it's not. It's also just the tip of the iceberg, unfortunately. I've been dealing with stuff more severe than that since a really young age. I didn't know when I was 11 years old that this thing had a name, depression. I just thought everybody in fifth grade had an internal monologue like the guy from Taxi Driver. It's very hard to verbally kind of describe what it feels like. I bet anybody else who has dealt with it would agree that's one of the very frustrating things about it. I can say this, even when I was little, I knew, I was never sure which version of myself I would wake up as on any given day. Is today gonna be a day where I'm really mad at everybody and I can't even explain why? Or today, am I gonna get really shy around people who I have known for my whole life? Or maybe today, I'll be really manic and try to convince the other kids in the neighborhood that we gotta get up on a garage and jump into our neighbor's pool? Or maybe today, I'll be too scared to even leave the house because I've convinced myself if I do, I might see the Virgin Mary and die like those kids who saw her in Portugal 100 years ago. Because I think we'd all agree that when you're born with mental illness level anxiety, the cure clearly is being raised Catholic. Catholicism doesn't help anxiety. It's like this man's watching you apologize for something. That's the whole religion. That's it. I didn't see this stuff hit its peak level until I was 14. That's the first age where I had one of my attacks. And these attacks have plagued me ever since. Basically, if my depression really gets going, I kind of can't like grab onto my thoughts is how I might describe it. I can't breathe, and my body is hot, and my face numb, like actual pins and needles when it's at its worst. My face goes numb. It's awful. So I bet the even bigger why is, well, why does that happen? And I'm sorry to tell you, no real reason. I wish I had one. I wish I had some inciting incident that I could point to and say, that's what caused this in me. I don't have that. I was a pretty normal kid at the end of the day. I loved basketball. John Starks, that's my dude, now and forever. Love Starks. I love pro wrestling. The Nature Boy, Ric Flair, that's my guy. A couple other people, that's nice, that's good. I loved comic books, but we can be honest, right? Marvel only. Come on. Thank you. DC Comics are bullshit. Always have been. They have a character called the Blue Beetle. Get the fuck out of here. That's not okay. You know? And comedy was the big one for me. Even when I'm 9, 10 years old, all I want to do is stay up late and watch David Letterman. And I start collecting Andy Kaufman tapes when I'm still in high school. And Saturday Night Live, when I was a kid, that's the best era of SNL. Chris Farley living in a van down by the river. It's the best, you know? So pretty average nerdy kid interests, you know? And no real traumas to report at home. My parents are still in love and married after 40 years. Like, I don't know. I don't know what caused it. Like, hate to say it, but sometimes people just break. Welcome to a comedy show. Welcome.